Uber has lost another $1 billion in the earnings report. However, rides are profitable. Sort of. Maybe. Who knows? It's Uber.
Xbox.
Twitter. Uber.
Postmates. OneNote.
Netflix. MoviePass.
Lyft.
Google.
Facebook. eBay.
DoorDash.
Apple.
Amazon. Airbnb.
The Apptrepreneur. Hey everyone, this is Kevin the Apptrepreneur, and if this is your first time at the channel, it's been a while since I've been personally doing a full-blown video editing. Might be a little stale, sorry, but hey, if you happen to like this video content, what you see, please consider subscribing below and ringing that bell. It was greatly appreciated. Even if you are subscribed, you might want to consider ringing the bell. YouTube's doing some funny things with the algorithm, and while I'm trying to figure out what they're doing and how I can improve, while I am checking out Apple TV Plus, we will have a more in-depth review of that later this week. But in the meantime, I came back from vacation. Well, really, it was my honeymoon, so, you know, having a lot of fun there. At the perfect time, because I came back as Instacart shoppers started striking, and Uber released their third quarter earnings report. And I predicted that there would be a $1.5 billion loss because, hey, that's what Uber loses every quarter, pretty much. $1.5 to $2.3 billion, almost like clockwork. Well, how correct was I? Was I off? Was I spot on the money? Well, they lost $1.1 billion last quarter. But they say the rides are profitable, sort of. Let's look at what's going on from ARS Technica. Uber lost another $1.1 billion in the third quarter of 2019, the company announced on Monday. This wasn't a surprise. Uber lost about the same amount in the first quarter of 2019 and lost even more last quarter, which was about, you know, $5 billion. Now, right off the bat, we will state, some people are going to point out, that last quarter they lost $5.2 billion. Said, hey, you see, Uber said that'd be like a one-time thing. Yes, nobody commenting on Uber stock said that this would be a recurring theme. There was a huge driver payout. There was stockholder payouts. There was a bunch of one-time expenses that are never going to happen again. But as someone who's been covering Uber for a while, $1 billion is a fairly normal amount of money for them to make. Would stockholders be okay with that, though? So, look, yeah, the losses have definitely shrunk this quarter, but it's nowhere near good. You still can't be losing $1 billion every earnings quarter. That's about losing $4 to $6 billion a year. It's just not going to work. Anyway, yet the company argues that things aren't as bad as that headline figure suggests. Of course, I'll suggest that. To show why, Uber broke down its earnings down by business area, distinguishing its core rides app from Uber Eats, Uber Freight, and other operations. Uber says that if you exclude certain non-operating expenses, mainly interest, depreciation, and stock-based compensation, the Rides app actually earned a substantial $631 million profit. That's enough to cover the company's core operating expenses, the company said. But Uber's profitability was dragged down by losses in other businesses, mainly a $316 million loss from Uber Eats. I question that. Just a little. Granted, I don't have their earnings report in front of me. I do not have the breakdown. However, as long as I've been doing this, Uber Eats has always been profitable, while the rides have been wildly unprofitable. So it seems kind of weird that all of a sudden, Uber Eats is losing money, but the rides are making money. I personally foresee the day that if the rides were ever to become profitable, then Uber Eats would especially be profitable, because Uber Eats is charging service fees on top of service fees, and they're charging more for the food than what they're actually buying the food for. There's a lot of reasons Uber Eats makes money and Uber Rides don't. Low driver pay, they charge commission and shopping fees that never go to the driver, and they will usually charge a little bit more for the food item, so no matter what you're buying, you're usually paying 5 to 10% more for the food. Uber's, of course, keeping that. And then, of course, if Uber is partnering with someone, Uber usually gets a cut of, you know, the sale as well. So, you know, there's a lot of reasons Uber Eats is typically more profitable than just Uber. So, I question this a little bit. Of course, interest, depreciation, and stock-based compensation are real costs. So the fact that Uber took looks less unprofitable excluding them isn't going to be particularly reassuring to Uber investors. But the reason these numbers could ultimately be good news for investors is that they suggest Uber's core rides business might not be perpetually money losing. If the EBITDA profitability of the ride-hailing business continues to improve, it grew from $460 million the year ago quarter to $631 million last quarter on the EBITDA basis. I'm messing that up. Try saying that fast. EBITDA. Nope. Tongue twister. Can't do it. The company could eventually reach honest-to-goodness profitability. The growth of Uber's ride-hailing business has been slowing down. It grew only 22% year over year. In the third quarter, in contrast, Uber Eats revenue grew by 77%. So while Eats lost money, that could be because the product is earlier in its growth phase and the core rides platform. Once Eats matures, it might wind up being profitable just like Uber. It's been profitable all this time. Again, I question that just a little bit. Well, anyway, okay. So here's the headline, bottom line. Uber loses $1 billion. And hey, it's not so bad. Things are looking great. How did the investors respond? Wah, 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 wah. Nope. Investors were not terribly impressed by this. In fact, many of them are even suggesting that the earnings are winding roads to nowhere. Uber Technologies revenue grew by 30% in the most recent quarter. Chief Executive Dara Khosrowshahi even expects a profit in 2021, he said on Monday. But which revenue and which profit? Investors in the $53 billion ride-share company have a dizzying array of financial metrics to choose from, and a new split into five reporting divisions has added a few more. The numbers that reflect activity by Uber's customers and passengers, from gross bookings and trips to revenue and adjusted net revenue, are all growing at a healthy clip. Other important figures remain stubbornly negative. Uber's burned $2.5 billion of cash just to operate so far this year. It has enough cash to keep up that rate for four more years, but that's a prerequisite for staying in business and not a boost. The main business of matching drivers with passengers made $631 million of EBITDA in the most recent quarter, 52% more than the year before, but only on a heavily and flatteringly adjusted basis. Uber, like Rival Lyft, now thinks it can be profitable in 2021, and the company narrowed its estimated loss for 2019. But will it actually be profitable by 2021? Well, they say they will. I'm kind of wondering, there it is. Khosrowshahi says right there. We know this. There is the exception of expectation of profitability, and we expect to deliver for 2021. You know, I can't think of too many companies, too many brand new companies that ask for billions of dollars in investments from shareholders and ask that shareholders continue to fund them while they are working towards profitability. Most companies don't even go profitable unless... they don't go public, I should say, until they are profitable. Uber and Lyft are stocks that don't operate by your standard set of rules. More and more, this is starting to look like MoviePass. I mean, I kind of championed MoviePass because I really thought it could work, and then, of course, it didn't, and I was very ignorant of it at the time. But look, Uber and Lyft, they keep giving away the money. I'm kind of looking at this, and part of me is wondering, like, you know, do Uber and Lyft ever discuss, like, the bonuses and stuff that they pay the drivers, because there's like a high churn rate? And granted, yeah, when they do that, yeah, new drivers don't complain about the rates as much as the old timers do. I mean, heck, this old timer's been complaining about the rates for like a good couple of years and hasn't driven those couple of years. So, you know, there's a lot of value for like a new driver, but do they ever talk about how much they really spend to keep recruiting new drivers to drive for essentially a few weeks until they get their $100 to $500 bonus and then those people just quit? Do they ever talk about that? Do they ever talk about how much money could be saved if maybe they tweaked the price of these rides and food deliveries to be more realistic so that the drivers can be compensated fairly? And if they're compensated fairly, they might not leave, which means there might not be any need to pay bonuses. I kind of wonder if any of that is ever brought up. So here's the thing. But how will Uber get to profitability? Well, here's the thing. Uber has set its sights on an adjusted EBITDA, which is earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization profitability in 2021. Karashahi said that to reach that lofty goal, Uber will have to, quote, drive lower rates based on the best technology out there rather than driving the growth through discounting. Lower rates. Guess what? That means drivers out there, you're getting a rate cut at some point. I mean, hey, if Lyft can do it for 35 cents a mile, why can't Uber? That's their next big thing. It was absolutely the right set of priorities for the time. Our priorities are trading. Oh, I skipped a part. He also said Uber will have to make other trade-offs to attain profitability. He emphasized Uber will move away from steep discounts of shared rides to focus more resources on new features that lets users save by waiting less longer and avoid walking to pick up location. Well, because the shared rides make the least amount of money. In fact, I think for ever since launching, it's cost Uber like $1 to $2 million a week to run shared rides in San Francisco. That doesn't make any sense. Like, you do that for a couple of years and it's like, look, it's not working. Granted, yeah, it will convince a lot of very poor people to use your service. But those poor people, look, they're not going to become loyal. They're just going to use whatever's the cheapest. And hey, if what you're selling the product for isn't making you money and they just keep using it, they're never going to upgrade to the better service. So, you know. Anyway, he also said, I would be very disappointed if Uber isn't profitable in 3 years. The investors are expecting profitability going forward. Well, investors were always expecting profitability. And yeah, I would, if I were you, I'd be disappointed that Uber's not profitable now. As a CEO, you were the CEO of Expedia. You should know that you don't play in the stock market until you're profitable. And yet here we are. This man's going to get fired. What can I say? He says, I think our rides business is the most mature business, so it is going to enter in an area of profitability sooner than our other businesses. With Eats, we're looking to get into number one or two position in every market that we compete with, and I think our investors expect us to deliver. You know, there are some analysts out there who said that Uber and Lyft basically went public because they ran out of venture capital funding, and it's really funny to look at this because, yeah, they're still acting like they're in startup mode. They're not acting like they're a publicly traded company. They're not acting like, oh, shoot, investors have bought stocks, this person being one of them. We need to actually profit. We need to do something right. No, they're still acting like, hey, hold on. Stick with us. We'll get there. No. Bite me, Uber. You're a publicly traded company. All bets are off. So, yeah. I think this is a disaster. This is an absolute disaster. And my mouse has stopped working. So, you know, we're probably going to wrap it up there. There's not really anything more to, of course, see. There we go. So, there. This is what I hate about ad-heavy websites. They just choke the browser. But I will not get an ad blocker because someone who depends on ads for my income, I could not do that to other people. So anyway, but yeah, so another earnings report. I mean, you have to wonder at one point, do the investors actually collectively say no, enough is enough? Because here's the thing, this drop, if we can, I don't know if I can get it over here anymore because the browser's choking because of these ads, but the stock drop was not nearly as severe as I think it should have been. I think Uber stock should be at most $20. This is not a company that is worth billions of dollars. It only went down to like $31.08. And that was, I mean, it wasn't much of a drop. Like, why on earth did it not? Oh, it did go down as low as 29. It's currently sitting at 29.37. So yeah, I did drop a couple dollars. So, you know, there you go. You know, I was talking to someone, after reading the Super Pump book, which I finished, by the way. And part of me wonders, like, is Uber going to fire Dara Khosrowshahi and rehire Travis Kalanick? I mean, I don't know. I mean, one of the things that stuck out to me at the end of that book was that while a lot of people in the company were happy to see Travis Kalanick go, they were also concerned because the days of reaching for the moon and conquering the world were essentially over. Dara Khosrowshahi was not that man. He was stable. He was daddy, essentially. And now the stock market is reflecting daddy's vision. And daddy, is not doing anything bold to bring the company to new directions. He's not fixing the driver problem. I don't believe Kalanick will fix those problems either. I think they need to fire Darrett and get someone else. In the book, they were strongly for Meg Whitman. If she's still available, she's probably not. I mean, I think she's the CEO of Wonderco, some new division from former DreamWorks animation CEO Jeffrey Katzenberg, so she might be off the table, but might want to get someone who can not only run a good business and is ambitious, but can also see where the core problems are. The core problems are this product is way too cheap, the drivers are not paid, so the retention is terrible, which just costs more money in the long run. And this company is spending, and they're spending way too much money trying to rewrite laws. Like, look, AB5 is law, it's a fact. They really should be just, they should be figuring out how do they work with it. I mean, years ago, we're talking many, many years ago, when VHS came around, movie studios spent millions upon millions of dollars to fight the new technology, claiming it would ruin their box office. Did not happen, and they made more money off the video market than ever before. You can work with, you know, technology and laws. You can just figure it out. But, you know what? I've talked enough about this. Bottom line, Uber's still making money. That's all we're talking about. Uber is just continuing to bleed money. And that's where we're going to leave it. So what do you folks think? Does this surprise you at all? I would love to know. Comment below, like, favorite, share, subscribe. If you enjoy my videos, consider becoming a Patreon member. It's totally optional, of course, but even as little as $1 a month goes a long way. Tell them the channel runs smoothly. You get access to my Patreon's exclusive blog. Also, if gas prices are getting just a little down, check out the GetUpside app below. It's totally free, but you get cash back on every gas purchase. If you want more content from me, check me out at other YouTube channels, Kevin T. Rodriguez, The Afterpreneur Vlogs, and Autograph Hound. And finally, if you want to talk to me or other fellow rideshare drivers out there, check us out at the Afterpreneur Hangouts on Facebook. And as always, flame responsibly. Have a good one.